I traveled to Africa in search of adventure. I was interested in the ancient tribal rituals in Zambia, which was celebrated several months of the year. Intrigued by the thought of witnessing the ceremonies, I decided to travel to the western province of Zambia called Baratsiland, near the Zambezi River, where I heard some amazing tiger fishing adventures waited. Zambia lies below the Congo, next to Angola. After a 10-hour flight from London, I landed in the capital of Zambia, called Lusaka. I found the locals very religious, mainly Christian. Everywhere I went, they played gospel music, mostly from Nigeria, of all places. I had to take a brutal 9-hour bus ride to the western province. The bus was packed with Africans. It was unbelievably hot and uncomfortable, with loud Nigerian music blasting from the driver's stereo the entire way. We passed several villages where locals were trying to sell us anything from chicken feet to cooked beef that looked like nothing I would eat back home. Every hour we encountered another military checkpoint. After arriving in Mangu, I swore I would never do that ride again. But a couple of beers and some friendly faces and conversation later, I was more relaxed.
You having a good day here?
Yes.
Ah, that's very good.
I booked into a motel suggested by my helpful taxi driver named Russ.
Well, Mangu is a nice place, no hot. Some people like the hot weather.
Over the next few days, I explored the fishing docks, decaying canoes and rusty old barges lay on the river banks. Plagued with flies and the smell of rotting fish in the hot sun, the poorly constructed village would be washed away every year in January and February when the floods came. Here where the river runs dead is the beginning of a new journey that leads towards the Zambezi River 2 hours away. He told me the Lozi tribe was the majority in this part of the country. Then there were Bemba from the Copper Belt and many other tribes.
Yeah, it's a tradition for the Luvalis.
For the Luvalis?
Yeah.
And do they do it every day or just once a week?
It is once in a year.
Once in a year?
Yeah.
This time?
This time, yes.
You're kidding me, then my timing is perfect.
Yeah.
Interesting. It's scary.
Yeah,
scary looking.
Scaring, yeah.
Is that part of the tradition to scare people?
Yes, it is the type of tradition.
So kind of like Halloween in America. It's Halloween is the holiday to scare.
Yeah,
so this is the tradition to scare
this is the tradition of, you know, normally see.
Does it go on for like a week or a few days or?
Even a month it can go.
Oh.
Depending on how they do it themselves.
Fantastic.
Yeah.
This truly was forgotten land where maybe once or twice a week travelers from Europe or South Africa would pass through on their way to a safari lodge somewhere on the Zambezi. The first few days was incredibly hot with no air conditioning and only a fan. Then at night trying to sleep under a mosquito net with mosquitoes biting you. I took my malaria pill every day, religiously. But the pills could make you feel very ill sometimes if you didn't take them with food. Thunderstorms rolled across the plains nightly, and I'd find myself walking down a dirt road at 2 o'clock in the morning with lightning and thunder above me in the sky. It felt beautiful, such freedom. This was wild Africa.
This is the headman of the village.
Yeah.
And
Ras took me to his village to introduce me to his chief for an opportunity to take some photos and video.
I mean, this village has been here for like thousands of years.
It has been here for a long period of time. how they live, it's where they grew.
And it's such a small village, so these people are like, they've been together, their ancestors are all from this village.
Yeah, in fact, we have just remaining with one headman, that's the village headman, meaning these others are just some children to...
These are the children of the children of the children, all in this little village.
They are the ones who have built this village.
Over generations.
Yeah.
And performing this tradition.
Of course, yes.
That's incredible.
Later I watched as the headman strolled across the village. This was his kingdom, no doubt. There was excitement in the air. I could see the children's faces. They were waiting for something to happen. They were preparing for the festivities late that afternoon on the riverbank. Some of the women started dancing and singing, welcoming me to the village. And I couldn't resist to join them in a dance, even if just for 2 seconds. They loved it. I could only imagine what it was like living here in the wilderness with practically no laws, except the law of the bush.
So, what are they?
Yes, it's coming.
Ooh, what's that in the back there?
Yes.
So what is this dance called? What's this?
Masakuya Mata.
Sorry?
Masakuya Mata.
What are they representing? What's that in the back there?
Yes, back there.
No, no, no. I'm just asking, what is that?
That is a lion.
Yeah, lion.
Oh. We're here on a hot day at the Tuyana village in Zambia. We're walking down to where the ceremonies are going on. And it's all the way down. The land is so beautiful and it's really hot. Over there on the horizon, all kinds of fires are burning. All around, actually, down there. Oh, you can hear the drums down there. We come to a closing here in the path. They closed it down so nobody can enter through here. So we'll have to go around and find another path that is sacred to the ceremony. We can't cross here. We're approaching some other villages here. Try and find another path down to the ceremony because the other one was closed. So it looks like we might be able to go through here. Lots of sand. Again, the road is blocked right here. The path is blocked. So we'll go through here. Oh, there they are down there. That's where the ceremonies are. Pretty exciting.
That's where they'll be coming from.
They'll be coming from where?
Just from here.
Oh, they'll be coming from here. And they're going down.
Yeah, drums.
Oh, okay. So they could be coming right behind us.
Yeah, they'll be coming right behind us. Then. Heading for the drums.
So we better walk faster.
Yeah.
Because I can hear them back there in the woods.
Yeah, yeah.
We arrived at the river and immediately there was hostility. A group of young men who had been drinking beer demanded in their language that I pay them to even be close to the ceremony. With local men pounding louder on the drums and beer flowing, the ceremony got very wild and out of control. I was not allowed to film any of this. Some ceremonial dancers, fully aware of my presence, swung their weapons pretty close to me. A female, completely covered in a freakishly looking costume, pretended to attack me. I guess she was just having fun. This was their Halloween, that's what I figured. I suggested to Russ that we get out of here, fast. Back at the motel, my headache went away and I felt relieved to be safe. I could hardly stand the ceremony for an hour, let alone for days like these guys did. I left early one morning on a day trip to the Zambezi River, about 2 hours away by boat. But an hour into the journey, we reached what the locals call Meeting of the Rivers, a junction where one river ends, and we had to carry the boat across the beautiful sand to another river and then ride the last hour to the Zambezi. This was a fantastic place that reminded me of paradise. No wonder the locals were always smiling. A bamboo hut like this on the water in Malibu would cost you $4 million. They truly did live in paradise. Somehow we got stuck here, halfway to the Zambezi. The boat broke down after a few hours of trying to get it going and having beers with the locals. The day was almost gone. And a big rainstorm was coming in. We decided to return to Mongo. Big disappointment, as this would be my only opportunity to make it to the Zambezi. I never did get to tiger fish. I felt sad to leave, but also glad to get back to civilization, where I had air conditioning and Starbucks coffee. Oh, and no mosquitoes carrying malaria. That was a good thought. Thanks to my friends in Zambia, and perhaps I see you again one day for a dance.